I'd like to extend a very warm welcome to all of you on this very chilly and cold evening. We're in tonight for, I think, a very intriguing intellectual adventure. Some of you who know Barack Obama or know of him or have heard of him and are perplexed about where this dude is coming from in terms of his political orientation, his ideas, tonight you will get the answer, okay? We have a very, very probing, interesting, I think, and important intellectual endeavor that we're going to be unfolding tonight. Many of the faces who are here tonight I recognize. If you're new to ethical culture, we want to encourage you not to remain new, but to come back and to get to know us better. We have some information packets in the back that lay out the purposes of the New York Society for Ethical Culture and its programs. We are a very program-rich community, a humanistic community committed to the promotion of ethical values and ideals, but not within the context of theological commitments. We are humanists, so to speak. And we do invite you to take a hard look. We do invite you to come back and enjoy all the riches that are part of the community. We also have a sign-up sheet. If you want to be on our mailing list to be informed of future activities of the New York Society, so you can come out and join, we ask you before you leave around some coffee and some chatter at the end to fill out the contact sheet so that we can continue to be in touch with you. Okay, let me introduce our guest for the evening, which means I have to put down the portable mic and sort of very pleased and very honored to have us with us tonight, Professor James Klopperberg. Professor Klopperberg is the chair of the history department at Harvard University. He was a summa cum laude graduate at Dartmouth and received his master's and PhD degrees at Stanford University. Professor Klopperberg teaches courses on European and American thought, culture, and politics from the ancient world until the present. Among other topics, Professor Klopperberg is interested in the history of social democracy, European observers of America from de Tocqueville to Max Weber, and the American philosophy of pragmatism, which I should say will figure in this evening's discussion. Among the books he has authored are, quote, Uncertain Victory, Social Democracy and Progressivism in European and American Thought, 1870 to 1920, The Virtues of Liberalism, and tonight we'll be interviewing Professor Klopperberg on his most recent book entitled Reading Obama, Dreams, Hopes, and the American Political Tradition, which is an intellectual exploration of Obama's thought and its origins. So please join me in extending a very warm welcome to Professor James Klopperberg. I should say that Professor Klopperberg wrote this book last year, and since then, he's been making appearances about twice a week, not only in the United States, but in Europe, in terms of explicating the mind of Barack Obama. So, this is the closest we'll ever get to the mind of Barack Obama, I think. And a marvelous opportunity. So let me start with the first question, Professor Klopperberg. What inspired you to write a book on the intellectual formation of Barack Obama?
Well, first let me thank all of you for coming out. This is not the sort of night that one wants to take a stroll in, but I appreciate your venturing out, and it's a pleasure to be here. I mentioned to Joe earlier that when I was in graduate school, I first encountered the work of Felix Adler and the institution in which we find ourselves, and I had a great admiration for the Ethical Culture Society for a long time, and I think it is an honor to be here, so thank you very much for inviting me. I was teaching in England at the University of Cambridge in 2008 and 9, and I was invited to a symposium at my alma mater, Dartmouth College, after the election. And as I flew from England here, I reread Dreams for my father, and then on the way back, read The Audacity of Hope for the first time. And I had given already, by the time I came back, 7 of the 8 lectures that I was giving at Cambridge on the history of American political thought. And I was astonished when I read The Audacity of Hope to find that all of the themes I had developed in those first 7 lectures are addressed in The Audacity of Hope. And I was completely unprepared for that, because as someone whose own politics are to the left of Howard Dean's, I hadn't been particularly excited by this moderate Barack Obama. But after I reread Dreams from My Father and read The Audacity of Hope, I realized there was something quite substantial about this man's engagement with the American political tradition. This was not a campaign book of the sort that we're used to in American politics. This was something very different. This was the sort of book that you'd expect from a professor of constitutional law who had taught at the University of Chicago for 10 years. This was a work by an academic that showed a really serious engagement with American ideas. So I began looking around, as scholars always do, to see what had been written about these books, and I found nothing. And that was astonishing to me, but I realized that we have a sort of built-in skepticism about the capacity of politicians to write their books. And so I began talking with various people about The Audacity of Hope and was surprised to find that even the friends I have who read everything about American politics hadn't read the book. While you're in Cambridge holding the Pitt professorship, as I was, you're invited to give lectures at almost every British university. And so when I was invited, I would give people the option of doing something in the research that I had been working on, or I said I had this little bit that I could do on Barack Obama, and everybody wanted to hear about Barack Obama. So by the end of the year, I had given a number of versions of a talk on Barack Obama to rapt attention from audiences of various kinds. And people began to say to me, you really have to work this into something because you have a dimension, you have a perspective on him that nobody else has done. The kind of intellectual biography of Barack Obama. What are the ideas that animate the man we've just elected president? So when I got back to the United States, I set out to interview everybody I could find who had ever taught him or worked with him or knew him. And by the time I had finished that, the amazing thing to me was that the portrait of him that I had come up with as a hypothesis based on reading his work was confirmed by the accounts of him that I was given by people who had known him in college, in law school, in the community organizing world, in the state legislature of Illinois, in the United States Senate. No matter where people encountered this man, they encountered the same person, and they encountered the person that I thought I had gotten to know from reading and rereading and studying his books. So that was the inspiration, to try to explain how it is that he got to be the person who could write those books and the person who had given the speeches that we had heard both on the campaign trail and in the first year and a half of his presidency.
Yeah. Your book is really a very rich intellectual treatise, and I'm curious as to how you actually did the research for it. Because you touch many different aspects of Obama's life.
Well, part of the reason I thought it was worth trying to do is that as an intellectual historian, as somebody who studies American thought, I heard echoes, both in Dreams from My Father and in The Audacity of Hope, of earlier American writers that I didn't see anybody else paying attention to. There are two dynamics at work in the book, and again, I think one has to have lived in American political thought for a long time to see what he's doing in the books. And I don't dispute the importance of his family, the importance of questions of race, the importance of the cultures in which he lived. I think all of that goes into shaping Barack Obama. What I thought I could add was an analysis that looked specifically at him in relation to these two different contexts. The first is the context of a revolution in American thought from the 50s and 60s on the one hand to the 80s and 90s, to the years when Obama really is shaped intellectually. That's a shift away from an interest in universal truths, timeless truths. And those are captured perhaps most clearly in the United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights. The title says it all, a universal declaration of human rights for all times in all places. So that's on the one hand, the belief that things don't change, that they're
there's a sense that there is an unchanging principle in the world. Okay. But on the other hand, who knows what the signal is going to be for on the other hand. But what follows that mid-century universalism is an increasing interest in different perspectives, in different historical moments, in change over time, and in the partial views that all members of all cultures have on what it is to be human. That's the intellectual revolution that Barack Obama participates in, and that those who are teaching him are very much a part of. So it was in part simply a close reading of his own books and his speeches and articles that alerted me to the extent to which he quite consciously and deliberately distances himself from that universalist impulse of the middle decades of the 20th century, the one that most members of this audience came of age sharing, and that he identifies himself instead with a set of ideas that go by very complicated terms, such as anti-foundationalism, perspectivalism, historicism, particularism. And I associate those with a variety of works that come out of the academy in these years. But the point is that you substitute timeless universals for the partiality of a particular perspective. So it's mostly based on his own writings, then deepened and complicated by a lot of conversations with a lot of people who both taught him and knew him.
Okay, I actually want to get into this, some of these complicated ideas. You mentioned that there are several, or you described several major intellectual streams or currents in Barack Obama's thought. I want to start with the current that you probably give the most attention to, and that is the philosophy of pragmatism. Can you explain what pragmatism means and how the pragmatism which you assert Barack Obama subscribes to and is an exponent of and puts into practice as a political figure, okay, differs from what you refer to as vulgar pragmatism?
In order to do this, I have to assume a certain level of familiarity with the history of philosophy. There are two different traditions that emerge in the modern era. A tradition of idealism that comes from the writings of René Descartes and descends into the writings of Kant and Hegel, Kant being the inspiring figure for Felix Adler, the founder of the Ethical Culture Society. And on the other hand, you have the tradition of British empiricism that begins with sense data, not with intuition, but with the information that comes to us from our senses. Now, these two streams run into the late 19th century as more or less self-contained traditions of thought. The American pragmatists, Charles Peirce, William James, John Dewey, and their students, doubted that either of those traditions was capable of yielding certain knowledge about most of the questions that really concern us as human beings. Questions of ethics, questions of metaphysics, questions of politics. And so they argued that where we cannot have certain knowledge, we should adopt the method of science. We should experiment, and we should remain skeptical. We shouldn't proclaim dogmatically truths that elude us. So this philosophical pragmatism is the adoption of a scientific or skeptical approach to most domains of knowledge. And one of the things that fascinated me in talking with the first teacher that Obama had at Occidental, where he began his college career, a man named Roger Boucher, was that Boucher, in the first 2 years of Obama's college career, introduced him to this way of thinking, not just in relation to James and Dewey, but as a way of looking at American thought and a way of looking at European thought. So people like Friedrich Nietzsche, Max Weber, are very important to Boucher and become very important to Barack Obama. So pragmatism is a way of dealing with the uncertainty that we face in the world and withholding judgment until the results of an experiment are in, and contending that most of the knowledge we have in the world of human affairs is provisional, it's tentative, it's subject to either proof or falsification in experience.
Okay, and vulgar pragmatism is merely what?
Expediency.
Okay, right.
Okay? And it's not obvious, if you've been elected president of the United States, that there will be a difference in practice between following the procedures of a philosophical pragmatist and doing what's expedient. Because your options are quite dramatically narrowed when you enter the White House. So what struck me as fascinating when this man was writing The Audacity of Hope as a junior senator from Illinois is that he already shows a very sophisticated understanding of a philosophical commitment to skepticism, to resisting dogmatic solutions, and a willingness to say, I'm not sure where the right answers lie. Some of the right answers might lie from the other side of the political aisle. It could be that Republicans have good ideas, a shocking thing for a Democrat to admit, and it could be that some of the ideas that my own fellow Democrats have been holding for decades should be discarded because they just don't work. So there's this anti-dogmatic approach to politics that I think is grounded, and I think based on the conversations I've had with his teachers, that is grounded in Obama's interest in the philosophy of James and Dewey. But once you become president, then trying to distinguish what's the expedient from what you're doing because you have a solid philosophical commitment to experimentation becomes very difficult.
Right. I want to pick up on the philosophy of pragmatism. Here I want to become a bit adversarial and basically articulate, if I can, some of the dissatisfactions that people on the left have had with Barack Obama and relate it to the notion of provisionalness and pragmatism that you've so well articulated. It seems to me that pragmatism, from what you've said and what you've written and what I know about it, rejects absolutes, including moral absolutes, as well as fixed points, generally, okay? But when we look at some of our greatest political heroes, people we admire most, and I'll mention a few, Mohandas Gandhi, Dorothy Day, Martin Luther King, couldn't we argue that their moral power stems from their idealism, that is, their commitment to fixed moral truths that they then use to critique the evils of society and inspire us, in effect, to move towards those ideals. In fact, I'm looking at our founder, Felix Adler, who's looking over your shoulder, and he was a philosophical idealist who believed, in some sense, that there was a realm of ideas that sort of floated above historical circumstance, floated above contingencies, and we have to look at those ideals as sources of inspiration by which to leverage change with regard to our really benighted political and moral situation, okay? So the question I'm asking is, doesn't it seem that pragmatism always seems to seek the middle ground, right? I mean, we're experimenting, we're trying to find out what's the better course between different extremes and so on and so forth. Couldn't we argue that pragmatism very often seeks out the middle ground and therefore lends itself, and here I'll be a little tendentious, lends itself to mediocrity, all right? There's something mediocre about it and not quite as inspiring as the type of inspirational power that moral absolutes can command. And isn't this really at the heart, to some extent, of the frustration that many progressives, such as myself, who may have been raised in a more idealistic era, such as the civil rights movement and the anti-war movement, would have with the plodding nature of pragmatism that is trying to squeeze out slightly better solutions from the morass of facts and data, as opposed to simply saying on the basis of ideals, this situation is wrong, and we've got to change it. And I've got to tell you, here I'm speaking for myself, I'm going on a little bit, I don't want this to be right. I believe that Barack Obama has the capacity to speak a moral language, but I'm still waiting to hear it. Okay? Well, that's my criticism, which is not mine alone.
Yeah,
okay.
You'll find it in the books. And I think there's no doubt that he has very deeply held ideals. And the three that I would identify and I discuss in some detail in the book are the ideal of autonomy, that is to say, the individual's capacity to decide for himself or herself what life to live. The ideal of equality, which for him is not just a question of political and legal equality, but social and economic equality. And we heard a bit about that in the brief exchange with Joe the Plumber. We've heard a lot less about it since the election. But it's there. It's at the heart of what drives him as a politician. I think there's no doubt about that. And the third is a commitment to democracy. And that, I think, is where he parts company from a lot of us on the left. He genuinely believes that the people who disagree with him are as truly and authentically American as he is. And most of us don't share that view. Most of us think we've got the answers, they're wrong, and they ought to shut up and go home and let us do things the way they really ought to be done. That's the way I look at it. But I don't think that's the way Barack Obama looks at it. And I think that's really quite striking. That's a very different conception of the purpose of politics than most of us on the left have. Most of us think that whether we can command a majority or not, we know the answers to the problems that we face. I don't think he agrees with that. The critique that Joe laid out has been the critique leveled against pragmatists from the first time that these ideas were advanced in the late 19th century. The first generation of pragmatists had their own very clearly articulated ideals. For Charles Peirce, it was the Christian ideal of agape. He was a champion of the notion of community, bringing people together around an ideal of love. For William James, it was a democratic idealism that he never expressed more clearly than he did at the speech he gave in the unveiling of the monument to the Massachusetts 54th, which stands on the Boston Common. And any of you who have read Louis Menand's Metaphysical Club, a book that I deeply admire, might remember a line in that book in which he says the pragmatist could tell you everything about an idea except why you would want to die for it. And I think that's simply false. If you want to find out why you would die for an idea, read William James on the Massachusetts 54th. John Dewey had an equally profound democratic faith, which also led him to a kind of democratic socialism at the most radical moments of his life, but that Dewey too insisted had to be grounded in the everyday interactions of ordinary people rather than imposed from above. And the reason he became so interested in education was that he thought the only way you could educate democratic citizens who would be skeptical, problem-solving, probing, scientifically oriented citizens would be if you educated them to think for themselves from the beginning. And that was the whole purpose of progressive education. So the ideals are there, but the ideals are always mediated by a confidence in the process of inquiry, which is a shared process in which many people ought to participate, and a shared skepticism of any individual's ability to know the truth dogmatically and impose it on anyone else.
Okay. I want to move on to another formative influence in Obama's life and an expression which he talks about from time to time, and that is the role of religion in informing his political values. And I want to get at this by way of his relationship to his mother. All right. Obama, and I think many people in this room took notice, when Obama, early in his tenure, had basically invoked non-believers favorably on several occasions, including in his inaugural speech.
First time.
And yeah, first time ever. Usually non-believers are usually the type of, are invoked in political campaigns to sort of shore up the patriotism of us God believers in the face of the unpatriotic and, you know, treasonous atheists and so on and so forth. But he actually included non-believers in the American mix. And I would assume, looking at his biography, that up until about the age of 25, 26, when he fell in with Jeremiah Wright and the Trinity Church in Chicago, that he himself, coming from an atheist father, and he refers to his father as an atheist, even though the father didn't play any direct role in raising him, and he refers to his mother also, interestingly enough, and I forget the exact language, refers to her as a crusader for secular humanism, and then goes on to identify her as a type of New Deal, Great Society, Peace Corps of liberal, and then further, even as he admires his mother, then goes on in a way that I was left a little uncomfortable with, sort of dismisses her as a type of naive figure as he moves towards his newfound Christian faith. And I'm wondering if you can talk about the role of religion and why you think he parted company with his mother's orientation in that regard.
It's a very interesting and important question, and one that I think we would be able to discuss with more confidence if he had told us more about his own religious faith than he has. There are several different moments in Dreams for My Father in which I think he gives us a window onto his sensibility as he's growing up. He refers to his mother and her parents with just those terms, and then he distances himself from those ideals. He calls them illusions. He calls them fictions. And he contrasts them to his own much more skeptical approach to such ideals. And part of that, as Joe and I were talking about before the formal meeting, is generational. That he is formed at a time when he's experiencing the consequences of the failures of the crusades of the civil rights movement, of the crusades of the anti-war movement, the crusades of the feminist movement. And so he does have a more jaundiced view about those people who seem to many of us to have been very heroic. Now, he doesn't hesitate to quote Martin Luther King and to quote Gandhi, both of whom he quoted in the recent remarks he made at the moment when the Egyptian revolution looked like it was going to amount to something. So he does align himself with those ideals, but he also distances himself from what he sees as his mother's uncritical relation to them. He describes himself at the end of one of the chapters in Dreams of My Father as a person who came to occupy the place where their dreams had been. The place where their dreams had been is where he himself is located. So I think what he sees is that those stars were fixed in the firmament by that generation. The challenge now is for us to figure out how we actually get there. It's not enough simply to say we'd like to have greater equality, we'd like to have greater autonomy for all citizens, we'd like to have justice. What do we do to make that happen? And that, I think, is the hard-headedness that he brings to politics. If you want to exercise power, you have to be elected. If you can't be elected, your high ideals may be fine, you won't change anything. Now, if you can mobilize a crusade, as the civil rights leaders were able to do, then you might make some changes. It's a little hard for us to identify what that crusade is in our own lifetimes. The laws have been changed. The substantive changes that will bring social justice remain to be done, and I'm with him. I think that's actually going to happen not by continuing to do community organizing on the far south side of Chicago, but by being elected president of the United States. The healthcare plan, from my perspective, is a very important piece of legislation, a landmark legislation, equivalent to what was done in the 30s and the 60s, that was done with a majority that was very tenuous compared to the majorities in the 1930s and the 1960s. Those were overwhelming Democratic majorities that put through the programs of the New Deal and the Great Society. He was working with a very, very narrow majority. The reason, I think, for our dissatisfaction is that we on the left projected onto Barack Obama a kind of radical politics that he never articulated himself. One of the reasons, I think, that I was not particularly enthusiastic about him is that he has been, throughout his career, a very moderate Democrat. He is willing to concede that for some problems, the best solution is actually using the market. When did you last hear a Democrat offer that as the solution? He's willing to say that some of the programs that we have used since the 1960s to deal with the problems of poverty have actually been demonstrated to be counterproductive. But we're committed to those programs. He's willing to say that some of the problems in American education may actually have something to do with the way in which it has been calcified by built-up interest groups within the system. Now, those are not the kinds of positions that we tend to think of as the positions of a person on the left, but they are the positions that you would come to if you were looking with unvarnished realism at the challenges we face and the problems we face. What I think Christianity offered to Barack Obama was an opportunity to add a depth to his mother's idealism. Cornel West, whom some of you know, thinks of himself as a philosophical pragmatist, but always talks about the need to add to the horizontal dimension a vertical dimension, by which West means not only the idealism of Christianity, but also the awareness of evil in the world, and the awareness of a propensity to evil that is every bit as much a part of being a human being as the aspiration to the good. So I think that what Christianity offers Obama is both a vocabulary of belonging to a brotherhood, of the sort he finds in the congregation of Jeremiah Wright, and an awareness both of a kind of aspiration that he sees as richer and more appealing than his mother's version, and also an awareness of the reasons why those ideals were not fully realized, which would have to do with the shortcomings of human capacity.
Right. I just wanted to ask a footnote to this. It seems like every American statesman, or many of them, have to either invoke the name of Alexis de Tocqueville or Reinhold Niebuhr. I mean, those are names that continually, whether they've read Tocqueville or not, or Niebuhr, you have to invoke their names if you want to show that you have some intellectual gravitas at all, right? You invoke, I mean, you have a lot of gravitas, and so does Barack Obama, but intellectually, but both Tocqueville and Niebuhr figure in your intellectual analysis of Obama. I want to talk a little bit about Reinhold Niebuhr, because that does play in to, I think, into Barack Obama's worldview and his Christian orientation. And I'm wondering if you can tell us a little bit. Niebuhr, of course, was a great New York figure, a man of the left, but a very complicated notion of progressivism, to say the least. And I'm wondering if you can tell us a little bit about Niebuhr's outlook, how you think it informs Barack Obama's Christianity. And maybe you can talk a little bit, because you do raise it in the book, that I think very important speech that he gave when he received the Nobel Peace Prize in Oslo that seemed to have a Niebuhrian, as I read it, a Niebuhrian sort of ring to it. So if you can talk a little bit about the figure of Reinhold Niebuhr and how it plays into Obama's religious faith.
I'm going to do that after I take your invitation to say a word about Tocqueville. Okay. Roger Boucher, as it turns out, at the time that Obama spent 2 years taking classes with him, and he is on record in a number of occasions saying these were the most important classes he had, and that Boucher was his favorite teacher. Boucher was in the process of writing a book about Tocqueville when he was teaching Obama in these classes. And it's a book that makes the point that what Tocqueville saw about America was that it was different from other nations in that Americans were engaged in public life, engaged in the political process, and that this is something that grows out of the New England town meeting and that distinguishes France from the centralized politics and the class-based or order-based politics of someplace like France or Britain. So this notion that democracy is the defining feature of America and that it is, at its heart, a messy business in which people disagree with each other and slug it out in the public sphere is what Obama cuts his teeth on as a student. Okay, Reinhold Niebuhr. Niebuhr is a fascinating figure, somebody who comes of age in the social gospel, who is actually quite far to the left, who runs for Congress in 1932 on the Socialist Party ticket. Right, that would surprise David Brooks, I suspect. Most American conservatives now love to talk about Reinhold Niebuhr because he, in the 1940s, begins worrying about whether people like John Dewey are naive, whether they are unaware of the propensity for evil, and begins invoking the more Augustinian notion of the gospel that focuses on the fallenness of humans and the need to be aware that people can do terrible things to each other. That's a very important part of Niebuhr. That's the part that David Brooks and other columnists love to cite. So when Obama invokes Niebuhr, many conservatives think that's who they hear, this tough-minded, astringent, no-nonsense Reinhold Niebuhr. Reinhold Niebuhr is also a Christian theologian of salvation who believes that God's grace makes it possible for individuals to love one another. That's the Reinhold Niebuhr that also, I think, appeals to Barack Obama, who is a theologian of a God of love. And that's the part of the Christian message that I think is equally important to Obama and that one never hears mentioned in the applause that people are inclined to, conservatives are inclined to give whenever Obama mentions Niebuhr. So I think it's an extremely complicated set of references, precisely because Niebuhr himself is a very complicated figure. And I know that Obama was made aware, as an undergraduate, of those different dimensions of Niebuhr. Whether a lot of that has stuck, how much of Niebuhr he has read, I don't know.
Yeah, but I was wondering if you could just talk a little bit about the Oslo speech, because I thought that that was, did say a great deal about Obama's worldview, and maybe a little bit also about his notion of foreign policy as well.
Yeah. Well, there too, I think he's a man of greater depth than most of the presidents we've seen in the Oslo address and in his Cairo address, which I think 50 years from now people are going to be dredging up when we look at the revolutions in North Africa that broke out over the course of this spring. That was one of the first speeches, as was the Oslo address, in which Obama said, the United States has often been a force for evil in the world. We've often extended our power in ways that have been unfair to other nations. When was the last time you heard an American president talk in those terms? And Joe's exactly right about the reference to non-believers in the inaugural and a few other speeches. Same thing could be said of identifying the United States with the Crusaders who invaded the Middle East. That's not the kind of language that most Americans are used to hearing when the United States in the world is the topic under discussion. So I think he does have a post-Vietnam awareness of America as a power that has used its power for a variety of purposes, not all of which have been benign. Now, he committed himself, both in the Cairo address and in the Oslo address, to trying to make foreign policy with that realization that we should be paying attention to the perspectives of those affected by our initiatives, by the exercise of our power. Whether he will be able to make good on that pledge is an open question. But I think if you look at the way he proceeded, or has proceeded so far, we better not put it in the past yet, in Libya, you see an almost perfect following of this script. First, wait, what's actually happening in Libya? What do we know about Libya? Who is the opposition in Libya? Once the Arab League weighs in against Gaddafi, once the United Nations passes a resolution, then President Obama is willing to commit American forces in alliance with NATO, but only to the extent that it is a humanitarian mission to prevent the slaughter of civilians. No commitment beyond that. A preventive commitment contingent on what we're going to learn about the opposition. Now, if you compare that to the approaches of both conservative pundits and pundits on the left, what's distinctive about it is the uncertainty that he's perfectly frank in confessing. We don't know what's going on in Libya. We know we don't want to see innocents slaughtered. Beyond that, we really shouldn't be so quick to make a decision. But that, I think, is yet another illustration of a very different approach to foreign policy than we've seen in the last few presidents.
Yeah, but doesn't that analysis, let me challenge this a little bit, doesn't that analysis break down when you apply it to Afghanistan? I mean, one could argue that he's being pragmatic in the sense of creating an American policy in Afghanistan that, frankly, to my mind, and to many people, seems incoherent. That is, increasing the number of troops and then declaring when we're going to withdraw them, whether indeed there is victory in Afghanistan or not. But I don't see this type of caution. I mean, that seemed to be an expedient decision.
Yeah. Basically, well, let me run the pragmatist interpretation
okay.
of it. Okay, you come into office, somebody who's been in the United States Senate, you consult with the military leaders, and they tell you, you know what? We actually can do this if we have just a few more brigades. 30,000 more troops, take those guys who were in Afghanistan or in Iraq, bring them to Afghanistan. I think we can get done what we think we need to get done. Given the speech he gave in opposition to the war in Iraq, many people assumed that he would say, nonsense, we're getting out right now. But if you go back and look at the Audacity folk, He said, quite forthrightly, I was opposed to the war in Iraq because it was a war of choice. I was not opposed to the war in Afghanistan because that was a war that was forced on us because we were attacked. We needed to go after Al-Qaeda. That's where they were. That's why we went into Afghanistan. When he announced the 30,000 troops going into Afghanistan, he said, what would a pragmatist say? We don't know what the result is going to be. My best advisors tell me this is what's necessary. We're going to look at it in July of 2011. If we're successful, that's great. It'll be time for us to come home. If we're unsuccessful, and we have no reason to think that this is going to make a difference, we're going to start coming home. So it looks to me like a scientific experiment. Hypothesis is 30,000 troops will make a difference. Run the test. If it works, then that's fine. Then it's making a difference. If it doesn't work, you don't keep beating your head against the wall. You begin to withdraw the troops. If he doesn't take that step in the summer of 2011, I'm going to be with you.
Let's get back to some of the underlying principles, ideas that he operates out of. You talked, in addition to pragmatism, you discuss at considerable length his commitments to civic republicanism and discursive democracy, some of which you already touched on. I'm wondering if you can elaborate those traditions, how they're rooted in American history, because you do talk about that, and how they play into, very importantly, what you see as Obama's commitment to economic egalitarianism. You don't quite name him a social democrat, but there are elements in his commitment to egalitarianism as he reads history and philosophy that sort of tend in that direction, although we wish we saw more of it.
Right. Starting in the 1960s, there's a transformation of the way that the community of professional historians understands the American Revolution. And thanks to the discovery of the pamphlets that were written in the 1770s, most historians come to understand that the animating ideology of the Revolution was not individual rights of the sort that we might associate with property holding and living the life of a hardy individual. It was instead this much older way of thinking that dates from the ancient world and is revived in 17th and 18th century Britain that goes by the name of civic republicanism. And the idea is that you come into your own as a human being by participating in public life. It's an Aristotelian idea that then is revived in the Renaissance and is all over these pamphlets. It's all over the constitutions that are written by the state governments before Jefferson writes the Declaration of Independence in 1776. In the year leading up to that, almost all the colonies wrote their own constitutions. This notion of civic virtue is all over those constitutions. So this new way of thinking about the American Revolution and about the Constitution changes one's understanding of what America is about. If America isn't only about rights-bearing individuals, but it's also about individuals who have a responsibility for the civic good and who have a duty to participate in the public sphere, not for their own good, but for the good of the whole, then the notion that America is all about hardy individuals looks preposterous. That looks like a construction of a later generation, because the documents from the 18th century speak the language of civic virtue, not the language of individualism. When I talked to Roger Boucher, I asked him, so how did you teach the revolution? The book he used, the book, as he put it, from which he cribbed his lectures, is the book by Gordon Wood, The Creation of the American Republic, which is the greatest, most convincing presentation of this civic republican understanding of the revolution and the Constitution. That's how Obama first encounters American history, through the framework of this civic republican understanding of the origins of the American project. The other version, the other dimension of this that Joe mentioned is the dimension of deliberative democracy. And this, again, is a Tocquevillian idea, which is then updated during the years that Barack Obama is at the Harvard Law School. The ideas of civic republicanism and the ideas of deliberative democracy filter into the law reviews of American law schools in the 1980s and the 1990s, when Barack Obama is first on the editorial board, then is the editor of the Harvard Law Review. So he is responsible for seeing into publication articles that transfer these ideas of civic republicanism and deliberative democracy into the language of the American legal community. Deliberative democracy is the idea, and Obama himself puts it very well in The Audacity of Hope when he talks about the Constitutional Convention. He argues that when the delegates got to Philadelphia, all of them had ideas going into the Constitutional Convention about what the Constitution should be. None of them got the ideas he had into the final Constitution. All of them had a new way of thinking about the Constitution as a result of the juxtaposition of competing ideas in the convention. So what emerges from that process of deliberation is a plan for the convention that nobody had going in. That's the magic of deliberation. If you listen to a lot of different people, if you have the patience to let people express their competing points of view, you might come to an understanding that you didn't have at the outset. From Boucher's point of view, the most clear analysis of this idea to appear in the 19th century is Tocqueville's Democracy in America. That's the way Obama encounters deliberative democracy. Then when he gets to the Harvard Law School, he finds the civic republican understanding of the Constitution and this notion of deliberative democracy as the two most important themes running through the articles that are appearing in the major law reviews of Harvard, of Columbia, of Yale, of Stanford. It's the transformation of understandings of America in terms of civic republican and deliberative democratic ideas.
Yeah, I've got to get to back to the economic issue, because that's so pressing. I mean, we live in a country where the top 1% owns 35% of the wealth. I think you mentioned in your book, although it's been mentioned by many people many times, that probably this is the greatest gap between those who have tremendous wealth and those who are without it in American history, certainly since the Depression. And you argue that Obama tends towards, based on, in part on these historical notions, bases himself on a commitment to economic egalitarianism. This man must be in agony at the moment, if that's the case. And I'm wondering if you can flesh out a little bit what you think his commitments to egalitarianism are, because, again, many of us see him conceding too fast. Okay, Paul Krugman and London, conceding too fast to the conservative opposition when indeed he might be taking a stronger stance for egalitarian principles in this regard.
Any of you who read the New York Times have been bombarded for the last 10 years with this data from Piketty and Sias, the economists at UC Berkeley, from David Leonhardt, who writes about the New York Times, from Paul Krugman. The most cogent analysis that I have read of this increasing gap between the rich and the poor is in The Audacity of Hope. And Obama points out that from his perspective, it's not economic imperatives that have driven this change. It's a cultural choice on the part of Americans since the 1980s. If you look at the period from 1945 to 1980, America's tax rate was both more steeply graduated or progressive than it has ever been in any other time in American history. Tax rates were higher than they've been at any other time in American history, and economic growth was greater than it has ever been at any other time in American history. Starting in 1980, tax rates fell, rates of unionization fell, investment in education fell, and the gap between the rich and the poor grew. From Obama's point of view, that was a political and cultural decision to renounce the commitment to equality on which America is founded. For his pains, he's being portrayed as a socialist, as an anti-American, as someone who simply doesn't get America. It seems to me that this is the first time in United States history that inequality has been offered as a positive good. It's a scandal. So I have to agree with you that I think he must be in agony. It's the domain in which I've been more frustrated than any other I mean, I should say most of what I'm trying to say, to do in the book and here tonight is to explain how I think he sees the world. I wouldn't last 15 minutes in electoral politics. I don't agree with any of these compromises. I mean, but fortunately, I'm a tenured faculty member. I don't have to agree with that, right? So it's easy for me and it's easy for Paul Krugman to stand on the sidelines and fire our howitzers at him. He's playing a game of electoral politics that none of us have to play. But I think the point you make is a very good one. He is on record as considering this the most serious problem the United States faces. I can understand the reasons why, given the problems he faced in the immediate aftermath of the 2010 election, that the Bush tax cuts were extended. But if he's elected for a second term, and if he does not do something pretty dramatic to address this problem, I think I'm going to be required to write a book called Rereading Obama that takes a very different look at the presidency, because I think this is a serious problem that so far he has not addressed.
Okay, good. Just a few other points for me, and then we'll open it up to the floor. This is primarily an intellectual biography, but you do talk about other formative influences other than merely intellectual exploration and ideas that have led to his current worldview and political stance. And I just wanted to quickly go through some of these. What effect do you think his mixed race background has had in informing his worldview?
I think it's not only a question of mixed race, I think it's a question of mixed culture. Because it is true, I mean, and that's the right phrase for it. Any place else in the world, Barack Obama is a man of mixed race. Only in the United States is he black. I mean, because of our one drop rule in American history. So I think he sees himself as mixed race and has been quite forthright about the differences between his heritage as the son of an African father and an American mother from most African Americans. And so that I think is distinctive about him, and I think it has caused him to see American history and contemporary American culture in a way from many African Americans, in a way different from many African Americans. Because, I mean, the most poignant example I think is when he's talking about his friend Ray in Hawaii in high school, and he's talking about the way Obama's talking about the way other blacks in the school are talking about whitey, and he just can't bring himself to use that language with any conviction because that's his mother and that's his grandparents. Those are the people who are raising him. And so it's very hard for him to demonize whites in the way that, you know, his group of friends, both in Hawaii and at Occidental and then at Columbia, it was just taken for granted that you would do. So I think it is a feature of his character that is absolutely crucial. And it gives him a particular angle of vision on a set of changes in American culture in the last 25 years that a lot of people have written about, and that is the way in which we are becoming an increasingly mixed race nation. California is already majority minority, and many other states will be following quickly in that wake. And if you've ever spent time at the University of California in Los Angeles, you've seen six students walking down the path and you can't identify the ethnicity of any one of them, you know that this is the future of America. And so I think the mixed race Barack Obama both understands that and knows that there is something particular to the experience of black Americans that is just not the same as children of a South Asian and Hispanic couple. There has been a different history of African Americans. And so on the one hand, he is simultaneously aware of what differentiates him from most African Americans, aware of the changing trajectory of America and aware of the very powerful legacy of slavery and racism with which all African Americans have to deal.
In that regard, just briefly, his time in Indonesia as a child, how do you think this is informed?
Yeah, that's fascinating. I just met last week a man who is writing a book about Obama's childhood in Indonesia and Hawaii. And listening to him talk about it made it clear to me that we're going to learn a lot from such studies, because it is clear that he becomes aware while he's in Indonesia, and that's what I was thinking about when I mentioned mixed culture, of the difference between Western culture, like American culture, European cultures, and Asian cultures. And his stepfather has an entirely different point of view from his mother. And as he describes the collisions between those two points of view, I can see him as a 10-year-old becoming something of a cultural anthropologist and understanding the cultural differences that are thrust on him every time he has a conversation with his mother, independent from the conversation he has with his father. They see the world in different ways. And so I think he comes of age a product of these mixtures of cultures, both in Indonesia and in Hawaii, in a way that very few Americans of his generation had access to. And I think that has shaped his broader, more cosmopolitan sensibility of America's role in the world.
And lastly, his commitment, several years he spent as a community organizer between Columbia and Harvard. How do you think that informed his political sensibility?
I'll give you one example of how I think it fits together. And this is one of the things that surprised me, frankly, more than anything else. Because everybody I had talked to had said to me, well, you know, it's fine to talk about Harvard Law School, and it's fine to talk about Columbia. But what really matters to Obama is those years in Chicago. That's when he becomes the person he is. And so I spent a lot of time with the people he worked with there. And one man named Mike Kruglick, who happened to have been a PhD candidate in intellectual history at Northwestern before he became a community organizer, told me that the person he got to know was a fascinating individual, unlike anybody else he had ever seen in the community organizing world. And he told me this story as an illustration of how Obama proceeded. The typical novice community organizer would come into a room, maybe this size, people with problems, ask them what the problems are, listen for maybe 5 or 10 minutes, and then tell them what they're going to do. That's just what you want to do. You're impatient. You know what the strategy is. You know what works. You've been trained. So you tell them what they're going to do. Obama, instead, would ask for comments and ask for questions and continue asking for comments and continue asking what people thought. And it would go on for hours. And then after everyone had spoken, he would begin drawing strains from that comment, and ask people to rephrase what they had said in light of what the other person had said. And by the time you had spent several hours with him, the people in the room had constructed the strategy. That's a very different way of envisioning leadership. It's a kind of leadership, but it's not the kind we're used to. And it's not the kind that most of us like. We want a charismatic leader to tell us what to do. That's never who Barack Obama has been. And I would argue that's not who we're going to see, even if we see him for 6 more years. He genuinely believes, I think, that deliberation is the most effective way to generate a consensus that actually yields ideas that people can buy into. It's messy, it takes an enormous amount of time, it's frustrating, because a lot of people don't have very good ideas, frankly, but it requires a commitment to the process of deliberation that I think most of us just don't have. Most of us think we've got better ideas than other people do. So from my perspective, this was a perfect illustration of pragmatism. He didn't know the answer. Deliberative democracy, he thought something would emerge from the process, just as it did at the Constitutional Convention in this little church basement in the South Side of Chicago, and civic republicanism. By engaging people in a shared project, you transform their sense of their relation to their community. So to me, this was the sort of distillation of all the abstract, theoretical inputs into Barack Obama manifested in a daily practice of how he worked as a community organizer.
One final question from me. You identify Barack Obama as a true intellectual, and so I ask, is it an advantage or a disadvantage for a politician to be an intellectual?
These days it's got to be a disadvantage. Clearly it's got to be. Because what we want are quick answers. We are probably the most impatient people on earth, maybe the most impatient people who have ever existed in human history. We want solutions now, and we want them to work right away. And I think being able to see all sides of an issue really counterproductive in contemporary American politics, because you really are expected to have the answer right now and to be able to articulate it with no sense of uncertainty. To be absolutely as cocksure as Glenn Beck is every time you open your mouth. And it seems to me a kind of dementia to think that that's a good quality in a president. We just had 8 years of demonstration of how problematic it is to shoot from the hip first and ask questions later. But I think you're quite right that the criticism that comes from both the right and the left about this man not being able to make up his mind and having to temporize and being so tepid and not sure of himself, he's thoughtful. And he actually does want to hear what other people think and consider the consequences of various choices that might be taken. It's a gamble in 2011, 2010, to proceed in that way on the national stage, because all the momentum is in the opposite direction. So it's a gamble that could fail miserably. I mean, he could be turned out in 2012 as decisively as the worst presidents who've been defeated in American history, or that 60% of the electorate who doesn't agree with us on the one end or with the Tea Party on the other end might say, interesting. A president who's actually committed to problem solving and doesn't like the sloganeering that we've heard on both sides for a long time and seems to have a fresh set of approaches to these questions, might be worth trying another 4 years. I think the jury is still out. I don't think we've seen the re-election campaign begin. And I think once it kicks into gear, that guy who inspired a lot of us in 2008 is going to reappear. My own sense is it was a deliberate choice on his part not to keep a fever pitch for 4 years. When he was elected, he said that part of what he wanted to accomplish was the lowering of the temperature in American politics. And I think that's been a very deliberate campaign on his part. I think when you head into re-election, that's when you begin to raise the temperature a little bit and you begin to inspire people like Joe and me instead of frustrating us all the time. What I'm trying to get across is that I think this strategy that so many of us find so unpalatable is deeply rooted, not just in the person Barack Obama, but in a way of thinking about American politics and American democracy that actually has solid roots, really deep roots, in the American historical record.
Well, let me just say, James Klopperberg, I personally find it a transcendent joy to be in the presence of somebody who knows something. And this evening has been a true joy, and I want to extend really my gratitude to you for thank you. The professor has told me he has to be back in Cambridge tonight. He's got to catch a plane, and so we've got to get him out of here by about 20 minutes to 9. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to spend 20, 25 minutes with questions from the floor. You can stay a little bit, I assume, to sign some books.
Sure.
Haymarket Books has been good enough to bring them along. It's a great read. I encourage you to purchase it when we're done. And then we're going to have to wrap it up at about 20 minutes to 9 or something. You know, later. Yes, okay. We do have a floating mic, so if you could. Oh, Frank, thank you very much. I have a question, and let's make it a question. Yeah, the back, Frank.
Wait. Yeah, I think as I listened to you speak, you may have answered what was going to be my initial question was why it seemed to me that he had failed to take on the policies of Ronald Reagan, and that what you talked about in the 80s, that there was a complete change, a shift in this country in what seemed to be our priorities and values, and that no politician has come out and taken that on. And as I listened to you, and I'm going to ask you for your response to this. As I listen to you, it sounds perhaps as though he doesn't see that as being his role. in though, as though, you know, I had a fantasy years ago in thinking about when Obama was elected, I could imagine Michelle saying, now, don't martyr yourself for these folks. Because I, you know, I think about the fact that Gandhi was killed by another Hindu, not a Buddha, or a Muslim. Yeah. And Rabin was killed by another Jew, and Sadat was killed by another Arab. And Obama, I mean, it sounds like what you're saying, his deliberative role is to bring people along, but not tell them where to go.
I don't think that would be either his style, temperamentally, or his conviction. I think you're right, that he does see himself. I mean, some of the pundits have thought they were making great sport in saying that he's the professor in chief, and Sarah Palin has adopted that phrase. I don't think that's particularly problematic. I think he actually does see himself as being both the chief executive and someone who has responsibility for lowering the temperature and raising the level of debate at the same time. And this has only occurred to me a few days ago, but I really do believe that anything he would say that would satisfy me would antagonize, in exactly the same measure, a much larger percentage of the American population. So what I most want him to do is what I most want him not to do, because it would make him unelectable in 2012. So I get what you're saying, and all you have to do is read The Audacity of Hope to see just how biting the critique of that cultural change is. But the question is, what do we do about it when something close to 20% of the American population, or the American electorate, seems to be interested in going further than Reagan? Do you let that 20% simply have enough rope to hang themselves, which is, I think, what his strategy has been? Or do you instead go after that 20%, hammer and tongs, make you and me really happy, and cause the 60% in the middle to say, I don't know, this guy may be a little too radical for my taste. So I think it's a very deliberate strategy because of the distance between what he's on record as believing and what I think is a very carefully calculated strategy to shift the center of debate one degree at a time until at the end of 8 years we inhabit a country that conceivably is as different from the country we had on the year he was elected as the United States was between 1980 and 1988.